Hello, welcome to a new episode. Today's topic is Network Analysis Part 2, Examples of the Networks and Communities. Today, we are continuing with the same topic as the last time. We will try to build adjacency matrix from the raw data. Then, we'll calculate the modularity of the network and detect the community structure. We will compare the results with those from the k-means clustering method. In order to fully understand today's video, please watch the part 1 of the network analysis. Also, it is recommended the episode on the k-means clustering. A quick recap from the previous episode. A network is composed of nodes and edges. The nodes are connected by the edges. And the closely related nodes may form communities or clusters, as we can see here. A network can be represented mathematically by a matrix called adjacency matrix. This is a symmetric matrix of ones and zeros. The ones mean close relations. Here, let's compare the k-means clustering with a network analysis. They are both unsupervised learning methods. There's a difference in the terminology. However, both clusters and communities have similar meanings. The difference between these two methods is that for the k-means, the number of clusters is given by the user, while for the networks, the number of communities is detected by the algorithm itself. Okay, let's see some examples. We have the data for the example in this Excel file named Example Network Analysis. This is the iris flower data by Ronald Fisher, published in 1936. This dataset has four variables, x1 through x4, which correspond to the different measures of the iris flower. Originally, this dataset also has a dependent variable y that corresponds to the species label. There are three different species with 50 observations or rows in each, with 150 observations or rows in total. Now, attention please, I will delete the Y column so that we are left only with the features X1 through X4. So the question we are asking now is, how much can we retrieve about the original classification structure that was contained in the y variable? To answer this question, let's first perform the modularity maximization. We go to the PrimaXL tab and then select Network. Here, for the data range, we select the cell range of the variables x1 through x4. Here, by default, the top 20% of the cosine similarities are converted into the edges. Then, we let the total number of communities go from 2 to 5. The seed and iterate are parameters for the optimization method. We can just leave them as they are. Finally, we specify the output location. Now, we press the run button. Great, we have the result. As we specified, the number of communities goes from 2 to 5, and we have the corresponding modularity values. The maximum modularity is detected for the number of communities equal to 3. It seems that the modularity remains the same for the number of communities equal to 3 and beyond. Now that we know that the maximum modularity case has 3 communities, let's bring the lower limit and the upper limit together to 3. When these two limits coincide, we can calculate the community structure. So we check on this box. Also, we check on this box to output the adjacency matrix. We check here to stream the output to a new sheet. As usual, we press the run button. In this new sheet, we have the adjacency matrix, which is a symmetric matrix of ones and zeros. We select this sheet named result. We have the modularity, the community structure, and a summary. Remember that originally the labels were 0, 1, and 2. Here, the labels are 1, 2, and 3. However, also remember that the labels exist in order to distinguish the communities from each other. So, they can be any integer value as long as they serve the intended purpose. Now, let's interpret the result. Let's compare the results of the k-means and the network. Remember that we used exactly the same dataset. For the k-means, we retrieved the original clusters with 89.3% accuracy. And for the network, the retrieval rate was 97.3%. I wouldn't jump into the conclusion and claim that the network analysis is superior. But for this particular dataset, the network performed better. What is important is that we are able to say that the optimal number of communities should be 3. Finally, a summary. Today, we use the network analysis as an unsupervised learning method. It turned out to be quite an effective clustering method. The network analysis can be suitable as an exploratory data analysis method when the number of communities or clusters is not known. Great! I hope you enjoyed watching this video. Thank you so much. Until next time. Bye.